Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents Star Wars Rebel Dawn, Book 3 in the Han Solo Trilogy by A.C. Crispin. Han Solo leaned forward in the pilot's seat of the wayward girl. "Entering atmosphere, Captain," he said. One-handed, his co-pilot made an adjustment. Han had met Jadana Velaz 2 days ago, after she'd advertised from Alderaan on the spacernets for a pilot to fly her ship to Cloud City on the planet B-Spin, after her arm had been injured. Han Solo had his own reasons for needing a ride to B-Spin. If it hadn't been for Jadana, he'd have had to dip into his rapidly dwindling stash of credits to buy passage for himself on a commercial vessel. With the credits she'd promised him, he'd be able to afford a cheap room and a few meals during the big sabacc tournament. The buy-in alone was a staggering 10,000 credits. Han had barely managed to scrape those credits together. The Corellian wished for a moment that Chewie were here with him, but he'd had to leave the Wookiee behind in their little flat on Nar Shaddaa because he couldn't afford passage for two. Han was staking everything on this gamble. He'd always been lucky at sabacc, but would luck be enough to let him win? He'd be playing against professional gamblers like Lando Calrissian. The Corellian swallowed, then resolutely concentrated on his piloting. This was no time to get an attack of nerves. Staying on their approach vector, Han sent them skimming over the domed buildings of the cityscape in the clouds and brought the girl down in a perfect landing. After receiving his pay and saying farewell to Captain Velaz, Han hailed a robo-hack to take him to the posh Yarith B-Spin Hotel, where the sabacc tournament was being held. Minutes later, Han's robo-hack pulled up before the Yarith B-Spin. Han saw a sign reading Tournament Registration in at least 20 languages and followed the arrow up the glide lift to the mezzanine. Han Solo had made it through the first day of play on luck and by the skin of his teeth. One of the onlookers was rooting for Han to win, though the Corellian had no idea she was anywhere within parsecs of B-Spin. And if Bria Theron had anything to say about it, he wouldn't find out. She stood at the back of the hollow projection lounge, watching the broadcast of the game intently, hoping for a close-up of Han. Silently, she rejoiced that he'd made it this far. If only he'd win, she thought. Han deserves a big break. If he had a lot of credits, he wouldn't have to risk his life as a smuggler. Something rustled at Bria's side, and she turned to find her aide, a Corellian named Jace Powell, beside her. Commander, the representatives from Alderaan have arrived. They're on their way to the meeting site. Time to get on with her mission here in Cloud City. When Bria had discovered that Cloud City would be hosting the big sabacc tournament, she realized that this was the ideal location for a top-secret meeting between representatives of several of the rebellions. Any intelligence operative knew that the easiest place to hide was in a crowd. With so many ships coming and going, a few humans, a Sullustan and a Duros meeting in a hotel conference room on Cloud City would arouse little interest from anyone. When she reached the meeting room, she tapped out her coded signal and was admitted. Bria seated herself at the long table and formally brought the meeting to order. "Fellow rebels," she said, speaking with the quiet authority of someone who had done this many times before, "I thank you for risking your lives in our cause. We of the Corellian rebel movement are contacting other underground groups like our own, urging all the various rebel groups to unite. Only as a strong, cohesive group can we have any hope of eventual victory over the Empire." She paused. "We know how taxing it can be for different species to work together. Disparate ethical and moral systems, ideologies, religions, not to mention equipment and weapon design differences, all of these things can present problems. Bria faced her onlookers steadily. But my friends, unite we must. Somehow we must find ways to work around our differences. The Duras representative tapped his fingers on the table. Your words are stirring, Commander. In spirit, I agree with them, but let us face facts here. In asking the non-human worlds to ally with you, you are asking us to put ourselves at far greater risk. Everyone knows the Emperor's disdain for non-humans. If an alliance challenged Palpatine's forces and lost, the Emperor's wrath would be mostly directed at the non-human worlds. He might well destroy us as a lesson to the human rebels. Bria nodded. Your point is well taken, Gensar. She glanced around the table. Minister Dalny, what are your thoughts?
We of Alderaan have supported the rebel movement from the beginning, the man said. We have provided intelligence, funding, and technical expertise, but this talk of battles is anathema to us. We are a peaceful world, and the way of the warrior is abhorrent to us.
Bria gazed at Dalny somberly. It is possible, Minister, she said, that Alderaan may not have the option to refrain from violence. She turned to the little Sullustan. Sion Tev, what are your initial thoughts?
Commander, my people are so crushed beneath the heel of the Empire that few of them have the wherewithal to plot any kind of rebellion. If we were to join a rebel alliance, it would cause civil war.
Bria sighed. It's going to be a long conference, she thought bleakly. I can't believe I've made it this far, Han thought wearily as he eased himself into the seat at the one remaining sabacc table. It was night on the fourth day of the tournament, and only the finalists were left. If only my luck holds out a little longer. The other finalists had also taken their places around the table. A diminutive Chadra fan, a Bothan male, and a Rhodian female. As Han glanced around at his fellow players, the last player, another human, sat down opposite Han in the last empty chair. Han groaned inwardly. Somehow I knew this would happen. What chance can I have against a professional like Lando Calrissian? Lando nodded tightly to his friend. Han nodded back. Forcing himself to sit up straight, Han picked up his first hand of card chips. 3.5 hours later, the Bothan and the Rhodian had been eliminated. Han assessed his hand. He had the card chip for endurance, which had the value of -8. Appropriate, Han thought. This battle is becoming one of endurance. He also had the Ace of Staves with a value of +15, and the Six of Flasks, value +6. 13. He needed to take another card to build toward a pure sabacc, that is, card chips totaling exactly 23. I'll take a card, Han said. The dealer tossed one down on the table. Han picked it up, saw with a sinking feeling that it was Demise, with a value of -13. Great! I'm farther away than ever. Just then, the card randomizer, an electric current which alters the value of card chips at random intervals throughout the game, rippled, and Han's cards changed before his eyes. Han now had the Queen of Air and Darkness with a value of -2, plus the Five of Coins, the Six of Staves, and the Master of Coins with a value of 14. Total value, 23. His heart leaped. Pure sabacc. With this hand, he could win the tournament. There was only one hand that could beat him, and that was an idiot's array. Han took a deep breath, then pushed forward all but one of his stacks of credit chips into the pot. For a moment, he considered tossing all his cards into the interference field to freeze their value, but then his opponents would know for sure he wasn't bluffing. Hold steady, he thought to his card chips, willing the randomizer not to change the patterns. On Han's right, the little Chadra fan's huge ears flickered rapidly back and forth, then he uttered the faintest of squeaks. Deliberately, precisely, the alien folded his card chips and placed them on the table, then got up and walked away. Han stared at his card chips. Hold, hold! His pulse was hammering and he hoped Lando couldn't see it. The professional gambler hesitated for a long second, then requested a card. Han's blood rushed in his ears as slowly and deliberately Calrissian extended a hand and placed a card chip face down into the interference field. Han stiffened. He'd caught just a glimpse of the primary color of the card chip reflected against the faint ionization of the field.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.